Good morning and welcome to the 33rd meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We have no apologies this morning, and our main item of business today is the continuation of evidence on the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill. Today we're continuing phase two of our scrutiny of the bill, focusing specifically on part four. This covers the abolition of the not proven verdict and changes to jury sizes and majorities. So we're joined this morning by Sandy Brindley, Chief Executive at Rape Crisis Scotland, and Mr Joe Duffy, so welcome to you both. And I refer members to papers one and two. And I intend to allow around about 60 minutes for this session. So if I may begin with a general opening question, and I'll maybe come to yourself, Sandy Brindley, first, and then Mr Duffy. So we understand that you both support a move to a two-verdict system with the removal of the not-proven verdict. So can I just ask you to outline what are your reasons for this position?
Yes, so the not-proven verdict is used disproportionately in rape cases. We're really unusual in Scotland in having two acquittal verdicts. So we have a number of concerns about how it's used in rape cases in particular. I think in combination with the significant evidence about the impact of jury attitudes and decision making in rape cases, our worry is that the not proven verdict could be contributing to wrongful acquittals in rape cases. But fundamentally, I think it is not correct to have a verdict that cannot be explained. I mean, I'm sure you'll hear from the academics who were involved in the mock jury research in Scotland, which is the largest study of its kind. And what they found was really people do not understand what the not proven verdict is and when it should be used compared to not guilty. Judges can't give any definition or any guidance around when the not proven verdict should be used. So it seems to me simply incompatible with a transparent, accessible justice system to have a verdict that nobody can define, and particularly concerns about how it's used in rape cases. So we support its abolition. I think it is the right decision. I think it's an anomaly, and I think it's time for it to go.
Okay, thanks very much. Mr Duffy.
I could reiterate exactly what Sandy's saying. I mean, it's an outmoded, outdated, unnecessary system. There is no requirement for three verdicts, especially when two of them mean exactly the same thing. I'm on record countless times as saying the only difference between not proven and not guilty is the spelling. I mean, that is an actual fact. And I've actually sat in a jury on a drugs trial in Hamilton, a number of years, 2012, right? And I can categorically tell you, virtually nobody in that jury had any understanding why not proven was there, because they actually thought it was some kind of safeguard, that if you couldn't make up your mind, you could retry them again if there was insufficient evidence. There was a complete misunderstanding. The sheriff categorically refused to define it and said he wasn't in a position to do so because some people had actually asked. It leaves people traumatised, and actually what you're doing, especially we deal with murder victims' families, and I'm talking about that from a personal viewpoint, and I can tell you that verdict leaves you further traumatised, because you've got a complete anomaly that shouldn't be there. Allegedly it's an accident, I'm not entirely sure, but Sir Walter Scott, you know the language he used about it, and he's right, because it just shouldn't be there. It's a total anomaly. A two-verdict system is perfect, it works everywhere else in the world, there's no reason why we should be any different. I agree with Sandy, we were all involved in the mock trial system in the Warwick investigation and report on it, and it's, I'll repeat myself, it's outmoded, outdated, it's unnecessary, it needs to be removed.
Okay, thanks very much. If I can maybe come back to yourself, Sandy, in your submission, you know, it's very clear that your sort of experience in terms of working with survivors is that they, you know, they feel that the not proven is a verdict that doesn't necessarily support them going forward. It's unclear, it's confusing, and they feel let down by it. But I noticed in your submission that you also comment on some survivors who feel that they derived some comfort from a not proven verdict rather than a not guilty. Would it be fair to say that that is not reflective of the majority of survivors' views as you understand them?
I think it is important and helpful to reflect diversity of views. Survivors are not a homogenous group. I think it's totally natural there will be different perspectives within that. And there is a small number of survivors who have said to us, at least it wasn't not guilty. So it felt like maybe it was the jury communicating some degree of belief. But for the majority of survivors that we have spoken with or that we're in contact with, they're absolutely supportive of the removal of the not proven verdicts. We've had campaigners like Miss M, Hannah Stakes, other survivors, both anonymous and not, who have spoken really about the devastating impact of getting a not proven verdict in their case. There's a really useful piece of research by Vanessa Munro from Warwick University, who did some interviews with survivors about their experience of the not proven verdict. And really overwhelmingly, what they're saying is this verdict actually got in the way of me being able to come to terms with the outcome of the court case, because I was left with nothing and no way of understanding it. And I think there's broader issues there that it speaks to about the lack of reasons being given for a verdict, particularly if somebody gets a not proven verdict. They simply do not understand what's gone wrong in the case or why the jury came to that decision. So I think there's a bigger issue there just about reasons for decision making that I know is picked up later in other parts of the bill.
Thanks very much. And if I can come back to yourself, Mr Duffy, again, just from your submission to committee, one of the what you say in your submission is that the vast majority of people are totally unaware of the court system and do not know what the not proven do not know that the not proven verdict exists. So you spoke a little bit about that earlier on about the confusion of what exactly that verdict means. I'm interested in what your thoughts are around whether or not it would be more effective if people, if the not proven verdict was better explained to people so that their understanding would be clearer, and that in itself might make the use of the not proven verdict more effective.
I think an explanation would be beneficial to everyone. I mean, for instance, nothing about the Scottish legal process or system is taught in schools worth talking about. I mean, you don't get any of it in school. You still don't get it. People don't know that Scotland has three unique verdicts, which they are unique. Nobody else has three verdicts in the world. You're asking judges and sheriffs to explain or define not proven. The definition is going to be it does not change anything. It's exactly the same as not guilty. So that would be beneficial in the first place. But the fact to not define it at all. But the vast majority, I mean, I'm still dealing with murder victims' families who are still getting not proven verdicts, right? I mean, I was in a meeting yesterday with people, and they're traumatised by it because they still didn't understand that it must have meant something, right? That's the understanding. If that verdict's there, it must mean something. So the explanation is paramount. You have to explain what is it, why is it there? So if it doesn't have a meaningful use, why can't you define it? And that comes back to those in power who are deciding on what verdicts are there and how it should be described in court. It's not described, it's not defined at all. I would actually challenge that anybody, if you went out the street just now anywhere and interviewed the next 100 people and asked them to define not proven, or is it there, why it's there and what does it mean, you will not get a clear definition. Most people don't know it's there. I mean, I'll go right back to 1992, when the man that, I can actually categorically say, that murdered my daughter, right, or her daughter, got a not proven verdict. I mean, my father, who was a reasonably educated man, except he'd been, apart from being an ex-minor, he was under the stand that must have meant something. That means they can recharge them. He thought it was like double jeopardy, right? It's not double jeopardy. It doesn't mean a thing. It means exactly the same. So definition is paramount. Explanation is, but the easiest way to explain it is, it's not needed. So just remove it. Right. It's long overdue. So you can divine it to your blue in the face, but I don't think, quite frankly, if you tell most people in a jury room that you've got two verdicts that mean exactly the same thing, I think all you're doing is leading to more confusion of which one it be given, because regardless of which one it is, the person's going to walk out of there.
Yeah.
So, yes, define it, but I prefer you remove it.
Yeah. OK, thanks very much indeed. OK, I'm just going to open things up to other members if they'd like to come in. Fulton McGregor.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to Sandy and Joe. It's just a very quick follow-up question to the Convener's line there, and I guess it's on... It was following on from your last point there, Joe, that, you know, the two verdicts are virtually the same thing, not proven and not guilty. No, exactly, as you said.
Exactly.
If it is removed, do you feel in your experience working with people and being in and out of the courts, and I know it will be hard to say definitively, but do you feel in your experience that this will lead to a higher number of convictions or for these sort of offences?
I have no idea. No, I don't know that. No, I don't. All I know is it's an anomaly that shouldn't be there. On the legal system and on how juries have returned verdicts in the past on various sides of things, I couldn't say that there'll be more convictions. I'm not saying there should be more convictions. I'm not linking that to... I've never said that anywhere, that there's going to be more convictions or fewer convictions because of it. But I just think that... It's usually universally accepted that there are two verdicts in this world, and there are, and they're guilty and not guilty, not proven and not proven, guilty and not guilty. So will it lead to more convictions? From a personal viewpoint and supporting the people we support, yes, I'd be delighted if it did and people would be convicted for the crimes they committed. But I can't say that that would be the case. I don't know. That would be down to the jury.
Thanks for that clarity, Joe. Sandy, what about yourself?
I think for rape cases, it's possible. I don't think it would be significant. But I mean, we have seen some absolutely terrible cases where there's been a not proven verdict. Terrible in the sense that the evidence to me seemed absolutely overwhelming, including where there's been significant physical injury, and the jury's decision really is inexplicable. I think in those small number of cases, I think it's possible that it might have an impact on the conviction rate, and in the sense that if it is currently contributing to wrongful acquittals in rape cases, It may rectify that to a degree, but I think it would be minimal, the impact. I think it would probably just be a handful of cases that it would impact.
Sandy.
So it's the right thing to do, but it's not going to have a huge impact to conviction rates.
Okay. Deputy Clerk, then John Swinney.
Yeah, I mean, really, I'm picking up on what Fulton was saying, in that my question was going to be very similar, really picking up on the opening contribution from Sandy in relation to wrongful acquittals. Because as you know, what the Scottish Government are proposing is by abolishing not proven, they would offset any impact that might have on conviction rates. So if you like, the balance between convictions and acquittals by increasing jury size. So how do you accept that would have the result that there's likely to be no change, given you've just said you think it's a handful of cases, and do you think the change in jury size does offset in that way, Sandy?
It doesn't make any sense to me at all what the government are doing here. I mean, if you accept that the not proven verdict may be contributing to wrongful acquittals, and it serves no purpose, so you remove it. So to compensate for addressing the potential of wrongful acquittals from not proven, what you're going to do is make it harder to get a conviction. It genuinely makes no sense. I do not understand the government's rationale in this. I mean, I've heard a number of lawyers arguing that Scotland's obviously an anomaly and having a simple majority, but that, to me, that's a separate discussion. Like, I don't understand the link with the not proven verdict. And I saw the senators' response where they're saying they think it's based on a false premise, and I also think it's based on a false premise. And I think what it means is potentially the overall impact of this bill could be to reduce convictions, which surely is the last thing any of us want.
Yeah, if I could just maybe follow up on that. So you referred to the mock jury study, but obviously what we've been trying to look at is what the evidence is for what the Scottish Government is proposing. So one of our initial questions, actually many, many months ago, was, well, what data is there? So to get an understanding of what kind of jury results we get at the moment, to what extent are they unanimous, to what extent are they very narrow, you know, results, if you like, in favour of either conviction or acquittal. Do you have any information about that, either data or just impressions in terms of how clear outcomes are on juries? What's what data, either hard data or impressions, do you have?
I mean, there is undoubtedly a need for far better data in relation to justice responses to sexual offences. I mean, we don't even have the most basic data of how many reported rapes lead to a conviction, because it's two separate data sets that aren't comparable. And I think that does raise a legitimate question about undertaking significant radical law reform, which I absolutely support, but without the data to underpin it or to make the case. And that this is an issue I have been raising, like, literally for years with the government, is that the need to improve the justice data and sexual offences. And the data that I think we really, really need is the conviction rate in single complainant rape cases. So what we know is that the overall conviction rate for rape is about 51%, which is far lower than the overall conviction rate, which is like early 90s. But I mean, it's certainly anecdotally, what I've heard is the conviction rate for single complainer cases is far lower than that. And this is often, if you look at judges' testimony from Lady Dorian's report from the review of sexual offences, what judges are saying, they're talking about not proven verdict being used at times where it's inexplicable in the face of the evidence. And that is often in single complainer rape cases. So that this is what I think we need, is much richer data to underpin these discussions. And particularly, I think, that figure about what is the actual conviction rate in single complainer cases, particularly when that's what the judge-led pilot is going to be focused on, is single complainer cases. We need the data and we need the evidence.
Okay, thank you. John Swinney.
I wonder if I could just try to draw some points out of what Mr. Duffy said already, because I think both the experience that you've recounted about your own participation in as a jury member, Mr. Duffy, I think is really quite insightful in bringing some further weight to the long-term argument that you and your wife and your family have pursued with such vigour and distinction. But it strikes me that your argument is essentially that the not proven verdict is a product of or a symptom of a lack of clarity in the judicial system. Would that be a fair summary? That, in a sense, because it can't be defined, and you made a very powerful plea for us not to bother defining it, but because it can't be defined, it can kind of almost mean anything.
It's a terrible thing to say. Somebody said it gives it a bit of a mystique, that there must be something so different about it that makes it beneficial, right? Which is an absolute, to me, a piece of nonsense. But if you have to describe an alternative verdict, why do you have it? If you can't actually say you have two verdicts open to you, you've heard all the evidence, is the person guilty or not guilty? Why are you offering them a middle ground? Why are you having to say there's a middle ground? But there isn't a middle ground, because it's going to mean the same as one of the verdicts. So it becomes a symptom of what we're talking about, data capture here as well. I mean, like, in how many trials, murder trials, rape cases, any case, is the level of information comes out on, is it unanimous? Was it a majority? If it was a majority, what's the majority? We don't know. Right, so we also have the thing with a jury that you've got 15 jurors. So did one juror send somebody home or send them to prison? Right, was it 8-7? How many times does that happen? So you're asking to define that and explain that. But if you're going to do that, you have to define and use better levels of data across the board to justify having it, if you expect it to remain. The simple, I keep going back to the same analogy every time, is that if you've got a third verdict that constantly needs definition, that the legal justice process refuses to define, and tell juries exactly what it means. Why do you have it?
I think the way you've just explained that with your use of the term middle ground is perhaps the best, because, you know, essentially, whether we like it or not, there is an encouragement to believe that this is a middle ground, but it's not actually a middle ground. It's actually on one side of the line, as opposed to... It's not in the middle. No. It's on one side of the line because it is essentially... It has equivalence with not guilty. But it gives the... It has the potential to feed confusion in a jury room about what people are feeling and what conclusion they're coming to.
Yes. If you go to any trial and listen to defence counsel will labour the one word throughout everything about the evidence that's being led. They don't say, is the person guilty or not guilty? Have they convinced you? They will use the word proven continually. And then they'll go to, if it's not proven, it must be not proven. They don't say guilty or not guilty. You go through some transcripts and have a look at them. Right? Especially in major cases and in a lot of rape cases, it will be laboured. If you're sitting through it and you've got my viewpoint, it becomes quite annoying to listen to the number of times it's used, because that's not what you're there to do here. It's not proven and not proven. It's guilty, not guilty or not proven. But the labour, not proven. And in the words of my darling brother, all they do is muddy the waters to continually move you back to the middle ground. And that means you don't need to make a decision. You can let that be down to somebody else.
See, that thank you for that, Mr Duffy. That opens up for me a link to the questions that my colleague Katie Clark was just pursuing there a moment ago, which is... And the way you've articulated that last argument, I think, is incredibly powerful, that from a defence perspective, there is an advantage in labouring the term proven, as you have just described. When we then address the questions that Katie Clark was putting about, well, if we get rid of not proven, is there a need for some rebalancing within the system, which is the government's proposition that's in the bill? That raises questions in my mind about, well, where is the appropriate balance of fairness in this process? Because whatever comes out of this, the changes we make here, there must be fairness on all sides. There must be fairness for the accused and fairness for the Crown to pursue its arguments. The government's proposition would say, well, if you get rid of not proven, you've got to have some counterbalancing changes made in terms of jury size and jury composition. And I'm just interested to understand the way you've articulated that point, whereby proven is labelled as a term, might actually be creating an imbalance in the system already. So we might just be removing an imbalance. So we as a committee have to consider, do we need to put in some counterbalancing thing, or are we actually changing the balance again? No, now, that's not a particularly coherent question, but it's a kind of... You hear where I'm getting at.
I think defence counsel are more than articulate enough to actually come out with a better phrase, just because you remove not proven. I'm saying they use it because it's in their benefit to use it. They would... some of the most articulate people I've ever heard are senior defence counsel, so I'm quite sure they would actually manage round not having it. You say the imbalance. I mean, the imbalance is that I don't know any process in the world where one set of people on one side against the other, whether defence, whether it be sport, whether it is, get a 2-to-1 chance. And that's exactly what you're given. You're giving the defence a 2-to-1 chance. They've got two verdicts open to them. Not one. So do you need to counterbalance it with something else? Okay, if you need to make changes to the jury system, make changes to the jury system. I'm not happy with the jury system at 15 anyway. First of all, I think it's too many people, and I'd also think that 8-7 is crazy, right, quite frankly. I've never only since, I have to say, as you're probably looking at, I'm a spring chicken. But, I mean, in 1992, I can categorically tell you I didn't know note proving existed, right? And I certainly didn't know there were 15 jurors. I mean, before everybody started doing this, how many people thought there were 12 people in the jury, right, as there is everywhere else, right? So if you need to make changes to that and there's a balance, yeah, everything comes out of balance, yeah.
You could see the argument for there to be a reduction in the size of juries, but essentially a higher threshold for conviction.
Yes.
But that's not a view that you would share.
We agree.
Yes.
We agree in the fundamental premise, yes, of removing the not proven verdict. I think your question is particularly apt. Why is there a need for rebalancing because we're removing the not proven verdict? I think the jury research is so helpful, but I think it can lead you down this road of doing all these mathematical calculations. Why do we want to keep the level of convictions in rape cases exactly the same as they are just now, given that I think it's obvious to anyone guilty men are regularly walking free? And I think the difficulty of going down the road of mathematical calculations is what you're not considering is, are the decisions the correct decision? And that, to me, is the key argument about are we enabling juries to make decisions, the correct decisions, based on the evidence, applying the correct legal tests, which they understand? And to my mind, that is not happening just now. A not proven plays a part in that, as does the question of jury attitudes. So there's maybe a separate discussion, which Joe is referring to here, about should we have a simple majority, should we have a jury of 15? But I cannot see any basis for linking that to removing the not proven verdict, because to me, that removing the not proven verdict is about removing, for rape cases, something that contributes to wrongful acquittal. So why are the government wanting to rebalance removing something that could be contributing to wrongful acquittal? As I say, it makes no sense to me.
I think thank you for that. I think I was struck last week in the evidence we took from the academics who were behind the jury research about the interaction that essentially is inherently constructed within their argument, which is around the relationship between jury size, which and majority or versus supermajority within a jury, and not proven, and that we laboured last week the relationship between these three factors. And essentially, what you've just put on the record, Sally, is the question of whether the correct decisions have been arrived at, as opposed to, are we making a change here, such as the abolition of the not proven verdict, which Mr. Duffy's made very clear his belief in. Is that the question alone that we're answering, or are we answering a hypothetical question about how do we maintain conviction levels at the correct level? At the current level, as opposed to perhaps at the correct level?
Absolutely.
And what concerns would you have in that triangle that I talked about there, jury size, majority versus supermajority, not proven? Would you just not have them in that framework? Would you encourage me to stop thinking about that?
Yes, I mean, it used to be, going back to the days of Lord Boremy's safeguard review, it used to be that not proven was jury majority changing would be the cost of corroboration going. And now somehow the jury majority changing is the cost of not proven going. And I'm not quite sure how that has happened, to be completely honest with you.
Corroboration strikes me as a fundamentally different...
Indeed.
Concept than not proven.
Yeah, indeed.
Totally. I, as the recent, judgments will tell us. Okay, thanks. Thank you.
Russell Finlay, then Pauline McNeill.
Thanks very much. I'd like to start, just pick up, Sandy, from the point you made earlier about data. Essentially what I would quite like to know is how many rapes are reported to police, how many are prosecuted, of those which are single complainer, of which those which are multiple complainers, and subsequently how many are resulting in guilty, a not guilty, and a not proven. But if I understand you correctly, we and you don't have that data.
No, we don't. We have data on the number of reports to the police. We have data on the number of prosecutions and the number of convictions. But you can't compare those two data sets because one measures by offence, one measures by accused, and also they're not the same cases. So we don't have any system of tracking cases through the system where you could say, for example, there was 2,000 rapes, of these 2,000 reported rapes, of these 2,000 rapes, this is the proportion that resulted in a prosecution, this is the proportion that resulted in a conviction. We do not even have that level of basic data, never mind how many of them were single complainer cases, never mind how many were male victims compared to female victims. We do not have the most basic data.
We've pointed this out, I guess, for a long time.
Yeah, many times.
So who has the responsibility to fix this?
It's the Scottish Government. I mean, I would say in liaison with the justice agencies. I mean, the difficulty I think I keep coming across whenever I raise this issue is that for the, for example, the police and the court service and the Crown, their systems are designed to manage cases rather than provide data. But I mean, there's only so many decades you can use that rationale for, I would say, before you improve your data systems.
Indeed. Now, not proven is an international anomaly. The legal profession, frankly, seem to have almost given up the fight on not proven. I get that sense. They are, however, very concerned about the proposal to not just reduce the jury size, but change the required numbers for a verdict to 8 out of 12, which in itself would be another international anomaly. I'll quote to you what the Faculty of Advocates have told us. The inevitable consequence of Scotland adopting a majority of 8 from 12 would be an international communication that Scotland places less value in protecting its citizens accused of crime than any and every other nation with a jury system. Do you share these concerns in any way?
I mean, like with the greatest respect to the faculty, it sounds similar to their analogies of North Korea when they're talking about the judge-led pilot. I'm just not sure how helpful that hyperbole is when we're talking about these issues. I think if we change the jury majority from a simple majority, that in itself is a significant change. I'm not sure. If their position is that would be such a dramatic loss of rights for the accused, it's hard to understand how that can be the case when it's a significant increase in majority rather than decrease in majority. And I think if you were to move towards a requirement or a preference for a unanimous verdict, you would literally never get a conviction in a rape case. It's almost unheard of to get a unanimous verdict in a rape case, even where there is overwhelming evidence, because some people simply do not, no matter what the evidence is, there are some members of the public that will not convict in a rape case, no matter what the evidence
is. But in many other comparable jurisdictions, there is a requirement for unanimity or one short of unanimity, and that seems to work. Is there not any sort of consideration that that might be the way forward?
All I can say is that in Scotland, if you speak to judges, they almost never see unanimous verdicts in rape cases. So what that leads me to think is if we had that requirement in Scotland, we would see a dramatic fall in convictions.
The jurors would kind of fall into line, but we just don't know.
Yeah, we don't know.
And Mr Duffy, I'd like to just pay tribute to everything you and your family have done for 31 long years of campaigning. You've spoken to probably every journalist in Scotland, every committee, no doubt, as well. And it seems that after all that time, the scrapping of not proven is within touching distance. I just wonder if, first of all, you thought this day would ever come in all the years of hostility you faced from the legal profession and others, and whether you thought it would even take so long is another way of looking at it, perhaps.
Well, hope springs eternal. I mean, going back to the days when we actually stood out in the street and asked people to sign a petition, long before you had proper internet or anything like it, we actually had people standing with a pasting table and some leaflets and shopping centres and everything else. I'd like to pay tribute to Marks and Spencers and Hamilton, which isn't there anymore, and the one in Glasgow for giving us coffee all the time we stood outside blocking their doorways. However, we always hoped it would come. It seemed to get further and further away. I will pay tribute to the way we were completely stitched up by Sir Ian Lang when he was in Westminster, and by accepting our petitions from us and congratulating us and telling us something could definitely be done, and 3 days later kicked it out completely in Westminster because we didn't have this at that time. So George Roberts, an MP, as you probably remember, actually helped with it greatly. But we always hoped it would come about. Yes, we've had the Faculty of Advocates in particular have certainly never been exactly our favourite people. They've never been very nice to us about what we do and do not know and why we're doing it. The only thing I was really flattered about is that it seems this bill has actually passed, according to two taxi drivers I've had recently, because they congratulated me on it being abolished. So I'd like you to get it moving and get it done, because these guys are obviously right, because they're taxi drivers. So based on their optimism and that, and the way the media seems to be relating it, it seems that maybe not proven might actually be abolished. But really, I'm not getting any younger, so the sooner the better, please. My family would, yes, we would have a party, and no, these won't be invited, but it will be a family party. But it would need to be a party, quite frankly. It would be a relief.
And over the 31 years that you've been campaigning, how many other families have you assisted?
Oh, no. That's a bit like Sandy's data. Apart from... Well, I was with one organisation up until 2014 when we started the Manda Centre in 2016. I don't know if anybody... Somebody asked me the other day why we call it the Manda Centre, because our siblings called her Manda, and that's why it's called that. So we still support families. So I as a figure, I have no idea. I could probably find it if I go back through and look at records and stuff, but we have supported a lot of families who have suffered the same way we have. I mean, even the family who originally helped us when we founded the first charity... I mean, they were, and that's why they got in touch. They were in the exact same position where it was an all pro, and which was, again, at the end of it, you couldn't believe it. I mean, I sat in Edinburgh less than 10 years ago with a family, and my wife was sitting behind me, was there. And for the jury to come back with the evidence I'd been given and come back with an all proven verdict was absolutely astounding. So it's the trauma, and I've said it already, it's the trauma it creates for families, and you re traumatise them by. There's no level of justice, that's how they feel about it, because somebody's just walked free.
And am I right in saying that most of those you've helped, similar to you, would have had no real knowledge of even the existence of the verdict?
That's
up until...
I mean, I've said it in my submissions. I mean, they have none. I mean, I've even put one in from the Manda Centre as well and spoke to the families in there who have been affected by it, and they were stunned when they got there, thinking, oh, well, it must mean something. If there's three verdicts, it must mean something. Yeah. And when they discover... that it's an anomaly, as far as I'm concerned, they're shocked. I mean, we've actually had families going, no, you're wrong. It must mean something. You know, they can retry them. And you're like, no, that's double jeopardy. It's the trauma, and across the board, I mean, I know the cases Sandy deals with, and we deal with, in the Manda Centre, we don't only deal with murders, we deal with a lot of other things as well, and that's coming through more and more as well, with people who have been subject to coercive behaviour, and it goes to court and everything else, and domestic abuse, and people are walking away and are not proven from it, a sheriff only. And that, it just, the trauma it creates is just, it's bad enough in any case, is before it gets to trial. When you're supporting people who have been affected by crime, they're in limbo till they get to the trial. Everybody's waiting in the trial, because then we'll get a verdict, then we'll get justice, and then they go there and they don't get justice. So the trauma gets exacerbated.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Pauline McNeill, then Rona Mackay.
Thank you. Good morning. Can I start to start with Joe? First of all, thanks for your evidence. You're quite convincing on this issue of, is it well explained? I don't have a strong view either way on the not proven verdict, I'll say that. So I'm just listening to the evidence. So my first question is, so presumably the judge, when they give the direction to the jury, as well as having to explain the three verdicts, will say if you have any doubt in your mind, you shouldn't convict. And I just wondered, given that, if you stripped away one of the verdicts, I mean, some people think it's more likely that what will happen is you just get more not guilty verdicts. Wondered what you thought about that, Joe.
I don't know why they can say that, because the one thing that's missing throughout all the data we talk about is jury research, proper jury research, where you can have mock trials, you can have mock juries and everything else. I'm telling you, I was on a jury, I can't tell you more than that, except I can't even tell you what the verdict was or why or anything like, because I'd be in breach of everything I agreed to. There is no actual evidence to turn around and say that there will be more guilty or more not guilty. There is nothing that says that. You can have mock trials, you can have mock juries, excuse the expression, to your blue in the face, but you don't know that, right? And you don't know that until there's a fair justice system which is guilty and not guilty. The judge and sheriff, even a jury trial, will say yes if you're not, you shouldn't convict. But in between that, they've said not convict, but they've also told you there's a third verdict there that they don't explain.
And that, but they do also say if you've got any reasonable doubt in your mind that you shouldn't convict, is that right? But and you've got to decide from there. The current system, if you like, if you have that doubt, then you need to choose which verdict.
So and I you don't say, think they're not guilty, but I don't think they're guilty, so maybe a wee bit guilty, so we're going out proving. Really? You're maybe a wee bit guilty or a wee bit not guilty. Maybe it's just me, but like.
But just wanted to establish that's, I mean, we're all lay people here, right? So we're only going by what we. But the judge would normally direct the jury to, if you've got reasonable doubt, you'd accept that, thank you. Sandy, I've got a few questions for you. First of all, I mean, would you accept that the scrutiny the committee have been asked to undertake is to make a decision in relation to all cases and not just rape cases?
Yeah, no, absolutely. It's used disproportionately in rape cases, and I think that is the site of a lot of the concern about the not proven verdict. But
so I've acknowledged that. But would you acknowledge that we have been asked by the government to look at changes that affect all trials, rape and murder and everything else? Yep. So I note the point you said about the Faculty of Advocates, but last week we had evidence from Professor Fiona Leverick, and she is also expressing the same concerns about removing the third verdict or one of the verdicts, that she would be concerned about the current proposals because she says it's out of step with the rest of the world. Just wondered if you'd heard that.
I think that's a separate argument. What I don't understand is the link with an unproven verdict. You know, I think if the government were to make an argument, which I don't see that they have made, that the policy document is saying it's because they're not proven going, I think there's a separate discussion about what should our jury majority be, what should the size of the...
If you did know that if you, that's what she said to the committee. So they're not. She's not the faculty. I'm just pointing that out, that she's given that evidence to the committee, so we have to consider that. But you also said if you accept that it's contributing to wrongful acquittals, but the government haven't said that either. That may explain where they're coming from. I mean, they've also been explicit to the committee by saying we're not trying to make any change by doing this to the number of acquittals. Yeah.
Yes, I mean, my understanding from... So obviously, most of the bill is coming from Lady Dorian's review, which didn't... That's not where the not proven part of the bill comes from. But my understanding of the recommendations of Lady Dorian's review is that they're addressing two key issues. One is re-traumatisation, one is low conviction rates. And the issue around low conviction rates from Lady Dorian's review is very much about jury attitudes and the impact of rape myths. And for me, that is inextricably linked with the not proven verdict about the interaction of those two things. So although the government are saying we don't want to improve conviction rates, my position would be conviction rates are very low. There are a number of factors that I think are contributing to wrongful acquittals. And I think that does underpin some of these measures in the bill. I can't comment on the government's position on it.
Thank you for that. That's a fair point. I mean, just lastly, just on this, three verdicts versus the current, you don't see why it should change. But would it not be fair to say that if you've got three verdicts, two of which are guilty verdicts, that's why we convict in the majority of one, which Joe said earlier? So if you like, you can get you can be tried and convicted of murder or rape on the difference of one vote at the moment. So is that not the reason why the government, if you remove one of the verdicts, would look at the ratio of the jury? Is that not fair to say you would look at the ratio if you take away one of the verdicts? I realise that's not where you're coming from, because you just feel there should be more convictions. But that we've got to look at not just rape trials,
of course,
all trials, is that not a fair thing for the government to look at the majority of the...
Yeah. I mean, I should say this to be clear. I'm not saying there should be an arbitrary increase in conviction rates, that somehow there should be a target of like 70% of cases must result in conviction. What I'm saying is we need to be far more confident than we are now that the right verdict has been reached in rape cases. Yeah. And it's what role do these different factors play in the right verdict not being reached? And I think it would be fair for a number of rape survivors to see the provisions in this bill as giving with one hand and taking away with another.
Yeah, but that's what I totally acknowledge it, but that's what I'm questioning you on, because surely... Without any kind of bias in favour of one view or the other, you could see that if you have a majority of conviction on one and you take away one of the verdicts, if you want to actually create a balanced system, is it not fair to say that you would look at the ratio of the jury? You might come up with a different answer, 8 or 10. Yeah. Is that not fair to say that?
Surely they're interchangeable verdicts, but they both mean the same thing, and I think it is probably correct, although Joe is right, we don't know until it actually happens, that the vast majority of not provens will be not guilty. So I suppose I don't understand why then moving to one verdict means you need to change the jury majority. That's the perspective of my organisation. I appreciate others have a different view.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Rona Mackay, then Sharon Dowie.
Thank you. Thank you. And good morning, Sandy and Joe. Joe, I just want to pick up a bit on my colleague's point about reasonable doubt. In my mind, I feel that, as I understand it, in order for a case to come to court, there must be reasonable evidence. If that evidence can't be proved, then it must be not guilty. I mean, that's simplifying it, but I think that's how I would see it. Also, your point that you made about not even... knowing when a not proven verdict is made, what the jury, you know, majority was in that. I hadn't even thought in that, you know. So again, that muddies the waters even more, as you put it. And I agree with that phrase. So basically, I just wanted to sort of ask you both, and I'm not talking about majorities here, just clarification for the record. Jury size, would you keep it at 15 or would you keep it at 12?
No, keep it at 15, no.
You prefer 12,
yeah,
what, Sandy?
Yeah, majority. Yeah.
I mean, I think there are quite convincing arguments about the quality of discussion being better with a jury size of 12. Like, I was convinced by that in the research, irrespective of the jury majority within that. In terms of jury size, I thought those seemed like quite convincing arguments or evidence from the research.
Yeah, okay. That's great. I don't have much more. Just want to echo my colleague Russell's comments to you, Mr. Duffy, about your campaign. And actually, it's astonishing that even after all your work, families still don't understand what not proven is. You know, after decades of campaigning, that there's still that confusion. And I think that speaks volumes.
I can talk on things like that. That to me, sitting in a jury room and not say a word was not exactly easy. And to let somebody else be the chair and try and
just do it as an
observation, and rather than berate the people in the room for not knowing. But then I thought that would have been me years before. So.
Yeah, exactly.
If I could say in that when we started the Not Proven campaign with Miss M, a rape survivor, we set up an email address for people with experience of the Not Proven verdict to contact us. And we were contacted anonymously by a number of people who had sat in juries. Yeah. And really what they wanted to tell us was just how horrified they were about the discussions that took place within rape trials, deliberations in rape trials, the attitudes being expressed, and also how Not Proven was used within those deliberations.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Kavina.
Thank you. Sharon Dowie, then Katie Clark.
Thank you. Just a quick question on the
the changes to the jury sizes, there is quite substantial changes within the legislation. Do you think the Scottish Government have got enough evidence at the moment to justify why we're doing the changes to the jury size? Do you think we've gathered enough information?
Strange statement. I hope so, yes. I think that if you're going to have change needs to come. And if you're going to change the systems, you might as well introduce the whole thing and actually fall in line. There's a line I haven't used. I've got it written. I mean, for instance, not proven about getting it and getting back to a jury size that's different to counteract that. Not proven is an offence to natural justice, because we've got a long-standing principle in this country of being innocent until proven guilty. Not proven or maybe guilty. So to have a jury size that works on a majority and not a single majority of one person out of 15 deciding whether somebody stays or goes, I would like to think you've got enough information, and there's enough information worldwide on how juries in that manner actually work. So I don't think there should be any reason why you couldn't be able to implement it successfully.
Sandy, have you got any thoughts on that?
As I said previously, I thought the evidence from the jury research was actually quite convincing and this about that you're more likely to have a fuller discussion with a slightly smaller jury. But it's not something we have a strong opinion on from my organisation.
No, that's fine. The other question, just to clarify for me, there was talk last week about whether we would go for unanimity with the jury or whether we would go for a simple majority. So what would your preference be for that, unanimity or simple majority?
Simple majority.
And one last question. The Crown Office has suggested introducing a system for retrials should the two-third majority just be missed. So if seven jurors out of 12 had actually went with guilty, so would you think that's something that the bill should incorporate?
I think it's a really interesting proposal. You would need to be looking at engaging for a rape case or for any case, really. You need to be engaging with the key witnesses in a rape case is the complainer. I think their views really would need to be quite determinative there about could they face the prospect of going through another rape trial. But I think there is something that feels fundamentally unjust for people that if they had a different jury on a different day, they might see their rapist convicted. And that is what that speaks to, that very, very narrow decision in terms of numbers. So I think there is a case for that. But as I say, it would need to be in consultation with the complainer, because for some complainers, the thought of giving evidence in two rape trials would be unbearable. For other complainers, it might be something they would welcome.
OK, thank you.
No, I would actually go along with that, because they're actually going to have the same, especially in murder trials, is that would a family want to go back through that again, and the witnesses and everything else? To get justice, probably yes in most cases. So, yeah, and that basic premise actually works in other areas anyway. I would say that should be available, let's put it that way. Whether people would want to agree to it and continue that, we then have to come back to the complainer or the victim's family.
OK, thank you.
OK, thank you. And Katie Clark.
Yes. If I could go back to the issue of evidence and data, last week we looked at the Scottish Government's proposal that jury size majority should be changed to 8 out of 12, but we also considered the possibility of 10 out of 12. And I appreciate we've got no hard data, there's no concrete evidence, but in relation to rape, can I ask Sandy what her impressions are anecdotally from the women that Rape Crisis work with as to what actually happens in terms of outcomes from juries, and how often she thinks there are unanimous decisions of a jury, either to convict or indeed to acquit, or how often the jury is split and what kind of splits you're told about. I appreciate you maybe haven't done formal surveys of women that Rape Crisis Scotland works with, but what's your impression? Because we really are, I feel, working in the dark here, so even anecdotal information is of interest.
Yeah, I agree that better data would be helpful. It's not information that complainers in rape cases are given. So generally, I think the judiciary are the best source of information there in terms of how often they maybe see a unanimous verdict in rape cases. As far as I'm aware, that data is not captured anywhere in terms of what the majority is, certainly not by crime type. I mean, it seems clear to me that the higher majority you need, the more difficult it's going to be to get a conviction. So the more you increase the majority, the more you're going to decrease the possibility of getting a conviction in rape cases, in the context where we know that decisions in rape cases often are not made solely on the evidence, and that there can be reluctance amongst jury members to convict. That is the site of my concern about the increase in jury majority, is potentially making it harder to get a conviction in a context where it's already very, very difficult. So if you, the more you increase the jury majority, the more you increase the risk of this bill ultimate result being less rape convictions.
OK, so just to clarify, complainers aren't given that information.
No, they're not.
And as far as you're aware, the Crown and the defence agents aren't provided with that information either.
I mean,
that's something we can obviously take up, but that's your understanding.
They're not told it systematically. I mean, they may hear what... It seems like very, very occasionally a complainer may hear what the jury majority was, either for conviction or against in their case. But that's anecdotally. So there's certainly, as far as I'm aware, and I'm pretty sure this is correct, there is no systematic recording of that information that could be provided to the committee. So we are absolutely dependent on any research, for example, mock jury research, and anecdotal information or sense of what the impact might be, which I appreciate is difficult for the committee when you're weighing up such complex and important issues.
Thank you, that's helpful.
Okay, thank you very much. We're just about coming up to time. So really, just as a final question, I just want to ask if there's anything else that perhaps you haven't covered in our questions today that you'd perhaps like to add before we close our session. Maybe Joe at all?
No, the only thing I would like to say is thanks very much for the opportunity to come along and talk to you and give our evidence. No, I've got nothing really to add. I think, as somebody commented on how long I've been talking about this, I think there's a very distinct possibility you're fair to listen to me. I'm not going to stop talking about it, though. And I'm just glad for the opportunity to come along and hope it actually leads to some positive changes for the benefit of the people we support.
Thank you very much. Sandy?
Yeah, I'd actually just like to finish by paying tribute to Joe and the many rape survivors and other victims who have campaigned tirelessly for this change. That is why this provision is in the bill, and I think it's really important to see it there.
OK, thank you very much, Sandy. So thank you both for attending this morning. At our next meeting on the 13th of December, we'll continue with evidence taking on the Victims Bill, and we'll hear from representatives of the legal profession and Crown Office. So I now close this meeting. Thank you.